We've got Captain Ben McGee. He's the Assistant Commander for Zone 6. We got Captain John Durant. He's the Assistant Commander for Zone 3. And then, and that's our panel members, so I'll introduce the rest of them. If you want to hold your applause till the end, we'll get through this a little quicker. We got Deputy Chief Rodney Bryant. He's our CSD commander. We've got Deputy Chief Sarah Lynn Davis. She runs strategies and special projects, CJ. We've got Deputy Chief Tolleson. He runs our criminal investigation division. We've got Captain Shepherd. She's the assistant commander at the airport. And we have Major Stacy Gibbs. She's from Information Services Section. And just walking in is Captain Brady. She works at our communication center. I also noticed that Rains Carter just walked in. Rains is our city solicitor. Just want to recognize him. So all of these people have taken time out of their schedules tonight to try to get the community together and talk to the community about what's going on in our communities, what we're doing about it, or what we see as trends and things to do. And I know all of you have something, some stake in the community and maybe some questions. So tonight, Assistant Chief Sean Jones will be moderating this panel. He'll moderate the questions. We're primarily here to talk about Zone 3, which is Southeast Atlanta, and Zone 6. Which is East Atlanta, some of the things and trends we've been seeing over there. So I'd like to try to stay on task with that. I live in Zone 3, so that's good for me. And my mother-in-law lives over here in Grant Park, so we want to make sure we keep these neighborhoods safe. But Chief Jones, can you come on up? Thank you. This is Chief Sean Jones, Assistant Chief.
Thank you. I just want to make sure we didn't miss our Chief Judge of the Juvenile Court, Brad Boyd, in our introduction, so we're glad you could be here with us tonight as well. We also have some of our colleagues, Joe Baker in the Fire Department. He's Interim Fire Chief for the Atlanta Fire Department. And I thought I saw Andrea Boone from Constituent Services come in as well. She's out just outside. Just want to make sure we acknowledge them. Yeah. As we start, just want to do a few housekeeping items as we get started. We're going to begin tonight with opening statements. We'll give everyone an opportunity to speak. We'll give our panel members 2 minutes to be able to speak with an initial opening statement. And then we have an opportunity for questions and answers in this process. In order to facilitate the question and answer piece, we will have index cards that some of you may have already have. You can go ahead and put your questions on those. Please indicate who you want your message to go to in this process, so when the question is read, we'll be able to direct it to the appropriate person. However, if you choose to use the microphones, we have two microphones positioned up front. You can choose to use the microphones in order to make your statements. Now, I know probably some of you have a variety of things that you may want to talk about tonight, but what we want to try to keep it focused to is Zone 3 and Zone 6 and really focusing on crime and what we're doing to address crime and the crime concerns in those two specific areas. So we will try to keep it, we will moderate it to that point. So please be mindful of that particular piece. You will have an opportunity to ask a question. When you ask your question, you will have an opportunity to ask a follow-up question as well. Then if there's clarification that's needed, you have an opportunity as well to seek clarification for the question that you may have in the event that the question the panel member may have not answered it directly based on what you were asking as a particular question in this process. We want to try to get as many questions in as we possibly can tonight. We want to make sure that we refrain from comments. We want to ask questions, so please do that. It allows us to be able to move the panel forward and get as many questions in so that we can get as many of your concerns addressed from the number of people in here tonight. And just in case I missed it, I definitely want to welcome each and every one of you here tonight, as well as our citizens in our community. I think what's most important about that from a law enforcement standpoint and from a community standpoint is realistically is what it's about, is that we're here to work together and to come up with common solutions as we identify issues that are occurring in our community. And we want to make sure that we're doing the job in a manner that satisfies each and every one of you in our community. So that's why we're here tonight. So please be mindful that is the overall goal. So as we move forward, we will have some opening remarks from our 23rd Police Chief, Police Chief George Turner from the Atlanta Police Department.
All right. Thank you, Sean. Appreciate you. Good afternoon. First of all, I want to thank you all for coming out. I see so many people here tonight, and that clearly lets me know that you're concerned about what's going on in your community. I want to talk a few moments around what we believe community policing is really about. I have several council members that have come in, Mr. Dickerson, Mr. Hall, then the state representative there, Commissioner Garner. Thank you for joining us.
Judge Morrison,
thank you for being here. Thank you. I think by us introducing all of the individuals that are in the House tonight, I think this is a prime example of what community policing is all about. When we identify issues in our community, we have to find solutions. Community policing is just simply finding that solution to what the challenges that we're facing. It is not a police matter. It's not a judiciary matter. It's all of us collectively partnering together to find solutions. So I hope tonight we'll have an opportunity to hear your concerns, and we'll talk about some of the things that we've been doing as the police department as we track our crime. You'll hear a number of things tonight around crime trends, and you'll hear what we're doing with Part One crimes. I thought I'd take a quick moment to talk about what that simply means. Part One crimes are the seven most deadly crimes, and the first they start with homicides, rapes, robberies, aggravated assaults, burglaries, larcenies, auto thefts, and then our fire department, they wrestle with arson, which is the eighth Part One crime that we're tracking. So what happens with that? We report our crime to the GBI. The GBI ultimately report all crimes in the state of Georgia to the FBI. And then that information is tabulated into a national database and suggests the information that we all react to, meaning those most violent crime cities in America. That's how that information is gathered. I will tell you up front, we are, as it relates to those seven Part One crimes, the city of Atlanta is down to the 1960 levels of crime. But that neither matters, that matters so little right now when we have concerns in our community. We can spend time really talking about how horrible the police have been, or we can talk about how we find solutions with all of the partners that we have in the room tonight. So I look forward to your questions that you have. I want to listen to the ideas that you might have and the concerns that you have, and let's work together to find solutions on how we solve our challenges. I want to also acknowledge our council, specifically the Atlanta City Council members, who have supported public safety 100%, and we have had a tremendous amount of success over the last 5+ years. I know that the mayor is on the way here. I want to acknowledge our 59th mayor for his support that he's provided to the Atlanta Police Department and public safety collectively. So, John, that's my statement. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, Chief Turner. Now we'll hear from our Chief Judge of the Juvenile Courts, Brad Boyd.
Well, thank you for being here, and thank you for the invitation. I've been to a number of community meetings throughout the city and throughout the county, and I know that there's always a big concern of what's going on with our juveniles, what's going on with the young people in our community. And I hear that in a couple ways. First of all, I hear some of the concerns about public safety that involve juveniles. I also hear concerns about what are we doing to get these young people on the right track so that ultimately they don't end up in the adult system. I will say that this past year has been the first year of what has been a big reform in the juvenile justice laws passed by our legislature, and they govern that reform, and that new code governs all kinds of procedures of what happens to a juvenile from the time that he's first identified as a suspect by the police up until the time that they are ultimately sentenced in juvenile court, and everything in between. It has to do with detention. It has to do with what happens to them when they are found delinquent, which is like being found guilty, and the kinds of programs and treatments that are available along the way. The juvenile court has several initiatives going on right now. We have a family drug court, which works to address substance abuse issues by parents. Particularly, those come to our attention through the Department of Family and Children Services, where children have been removed from the parents. And we have a drug court for parents. We have a drug court for juveniles. We are beginning the work on trying to establish a mental health court for juveniles, because there is a significant amount of mental health issues that we are finding in the young people that come before our courts. We have a couple other initiatives that are going on right now. We've gotten a grant to deal with those special needs children that are involved both in the juvenile justice system and in the child welfare system. Statistics show that those are very high-risk young people. And there are some jurisdictions that have set up some special programs and special ways of dealing with those particularly young people, and we are working on developing a similar program in Fulton County. We also have the beginnings of another project that we are starting working with the Atlanta and Fulton County school systems. It's called Pathways to School Pathways. And the whole project is to try to work with the schools and in partnership with the schools and the community to try to develop means of addressing early behavior problems that are addressed in school, to try to keep the kids focused and do with early intervention so they don't get pushed into the court system, where inevitably they seem to deteriorate once they get there. And finally, we have some grants from the state to work with what are called the high-end kids. These are kids that have more serious offenses that in the past have been committed to the State Department of Juvenile Justice and have been placed in secure facilities. A study of those children that were placed in those facilities found out that the recidivism rate was something like 90%. And we have identified, along with the state, some evidence-based programs that have been shown through research to make a much more significant impact and improvement on youth behavior. And we have some of our young people involved in these new programs, some of which are being funded with a grant from the state. So there are a lot of new initiatives going on. We welcome your input, your questions, and your observation at the court.
All right, Judge Boyd, thank you. All right, we have two individuals. They're holding red buckets at both the entrance and the exits. On the back of your registration cards, if you would write your questions on the back of those cards and raise it up, and these young ladies, they'll come and they'll get it, and we'll be able to read your question as we move forward.
Excuse me, we can't hear you very well back here. Can you talk louder?
Yes, ma'am. We have two individuals. We have two individuals at the doors, at the exits, at the entrance. If you just write your questions on the back of the registration cards, they'll collect those, and we'll be able to read those cards, read your questions as we move forward. Thank you. Okay. Reigns Carter. Okay.
Good afternoon. I'm Reigns Carter, City Solicitor, and I want to pause and acknowledge our Mayor, Honorable Kasim Reed, has joined us.
Yes, sir. How you doing? Mayor Reed, we're doing our opening statements. Would you like to go now? We can go now. Yeah. With opening statements.
I'm happy to go now.
Yes, sir.
Good evening.
Good evening.
The reason that I'm here is to let you know that while we have seen crime trends at 40-year lows, that we hear your concerns loud and clear regarding the level of violence that our neighborhoods have been facing, and that we're going to use a number of tactics to address it. One of the things that I'm going to do is to authorize Chief Turner to run significantly enhanced patrols to address the kind of behavior that we're seeing that's totally unacceptable. And so rather than having a meeting tonight where I cite our statistical data, which is very favorable, we're going to deal with what people are going through day in and day out right now, which are incidents related to burglary, related to shootings, that are unacceptable to me and unacceptable to the command staff at our police department. We do need help in one regard, though. We spent about a year working in partnership with our county partners on this issue of repeat offenders. And so what you're going to hear from the command staff is a great deal of the individuals who we catch are frequently a part of this repeat offender problem. So rather than to criticize our county partners, what we're going to do is to try to push harder on the amount of cooperation that we have between Atlanta and Fulton County. But I'm willing to be held accountable, and so is my command team. But what you have to know is that we have a problem with a revolving door as it relates to the county and the city that has to be resolved. It's got to be resolved. And it's not something that I can resolve alone. So what we're doing a far better job of right now is when you hear about awful incidents, although it's not as well reported, we are capturing those individuals. So there was a shooting last night. The perpetrator ended up being shot. Everybody knows about the person who was killed at Kroger. We captured that individual. Our clear-up record is very favorable. But what I also want you to know is when you look at the individuals who are committing crimes in our city, the women and men on our police department have frequently captured them before. And I don't mean they captured them 10 times, they've captured them 20 times, and they've captured them 30 times. And so if you really want to turn the tide, I need your help in that regard. But we are expanding our capabilities all of the time. We have the biggest force that we've ever had before. We're using PredPol. It is helping us. It's a predictive policing method which looks at where crime is occurring and gives us some sense of where crime is going to be occurring in the future. We have expanded the number of video cameras which allow us to give us a situational awareness that we have not had before. And as a part of the infrastructure bond that you all passed on March 17th, we're going to expand that capability. And we're adding man hours and women hours. So I don't need any notes, because when you all are awake and concerned, I'm awake and concerned. Every time there's a robbery or a shooting or a serious criminal offense in the city of Atlanta, I become aware of it almost as quickly as the chief of police becomes aware of it. But I just want you to know, fortunately, we're in a position where we can put all of the resources that are necessary to try to turn the tide of violence as we go into our summer. And so what we came to do tonight is to answer detailed questions with the folks who will be doing this day in and day out. But I wanted to look you in the eye and let you know in no uncertain terms that our women and men will have every resource that they will need in order to keep you safe in your homes. And so with that, I want to acknowledge Councilmember C.T. Martin, who is here. Councilmember Kwanzaa Hall is here. Councilmember Andre Dickens is here tonight, as is our county partner, Joan Garner. But if anybody wants to know what we can do to stop it, number one, we're going to increase the level of police force and protection immediately, right away. But we've got to get our arms around this repeat offender issue. If we can put in jail the people that our officers catch, we can reduce the number of criminal activity by 10 to 20%. And we've already reduced it to the lowest levels that it's been in 40 years. So I'm very sorry for what you all are going through right now. And we are going to fix it. We're going to fix it. And we're going to fix it in terms of the data that you all can monitor that's verifiable. But we can only do it with your help and support. So it's got to be greater collaboration where you all are telling us what is going on so we can act on that. With that, I'm going to turn the microphone over to the professionals and listen to your input. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Mayor Reed. Now, City Solicitor Raines Carter.
Yeah. Good evening. I'm Raines Carter, City Solicitor, and I am so happy to be able to follow the mayor because I want to tell you another aspect of what his administration has done, along with these council members that are here and all of our city council. Not only has the mayor strengthened our law enforcement, this administration and this council has rebuilt our court system. We were at a point a few years ago where our court system was about to be privatized. And the mayor, under his leadership, Councilman Martin, Kwanzaa Hall, Felicia Moore, many others that are here, put their heads together and realized that our city court system is a real part of the system because it's the initial point of contact for most people. Just about everybody in here has at least had to deal with a traffic ticket. But even beyond that, the minor crimes, the misdemeanors, the shopliftings, the things that we share in terms of jurisdiction with the juvenile court are the most crimes. And we certainly understand that we have to deal in a very serious way with the major felony offenses. So what we have done now in our solicitor's office, we have partnered with Mr. Paul Howard in the DA's office, Ms. Carmen Smith in the state solicitor general's office, and we exchange information too because we play a very real part in doing something about this revolving door that the mayor is talking about recidivism. One of the things that we found when we sat down as prosecutors is that these people cross-offend. And what I mean by that is they may commit a felony last week. A couple of weeks from now, they'll commit a misdemeanor. 3 months from now, they'll commit an ordinance violation. Well, there was a point in time where prosecutors weren't sharing that information. We are doing that now. Mayor Reed and this council has brought us to the table. And I am here not only to answer your questions about criminal offenses, but also to make it clear to you that our code violations have an impact on the criminal offenses. It's the broken window theory, where you have dilapidated property, where you have trash, debris. Those things are breeding grounds for other types of crime, and they seem to escalate at a point. So I'm happy to be made a part of this process. You're going to be seeing more of me. We have the right people in the room and in this city to make you safe, and that is our pledge to you. And thank you so much for having me this evening. Thank you.
So now we'll hear from our Zone 3 Assistant Commander, Captain Jonathan Durant.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
We are Zone 3, Southeast Atlanta and part of Southwest Atlanta. I am the Assistant Commander, John Durant. The Commander, Major Glazier, finally got to spend some time with his children this week, so he's on spring break down in Daytona Beach, so I hope he's having a good time down there. But we are responsible for the southeastern portion of Atlanta, and I've been on the department for 27 years myself, so I've been around, I've seen a lot, I've grown with this department, and I like the way this department is heading right now. One of the biggest concerns we have in the Zone 3 community is the rise in crime of our juveniles. Our juveniles hanging in these groups and committing a lot of property thefts, breaking in cars, breaking in houses, and exacting revenge on each other when they don't like each other, when they see somebody they don't like, or they see somebody who belongs somewhere else, they would think. So we definitely have a problem with that issue right now. We're addressing that aggressively. We have created what we call a burglary task force team. We got four officers that do nothing but go out on burglars, fingerprint it, get DNA if they can, and they follow up on it. And they're doing a great job at it. And we also incorporated a larceny from auto team, because that's a big problem we have also out there in Zone 3. They're breaking in a lot of cars these days. Opportunistic criminals. They walk by car, they see some of the value in the car, they'll pop a window out and try to get something out and take it and sell it, whatever they can get for it. So we have created a team with our burglary team to address that. And then we have our crime suppression unit that we've created. It's a 12-man team that don't answer 911 calls. Their primary responsibility is to go address crime patterns that we notice, that we see that's arising in the Zone 3 area. They're very effective. They go out there, they make a lot of cases, they're real visible, and they go in the neighborhoods to be seen and to get the criminals off of the street. With the Braves coming up, we have to put them out there around the Braves a lot to protect all the citizens that come to town to watch the Braves play, all the ones that live there watch the Braves play, to protect their cars and protect their persons as they go to and from their cars. So the crime suppression unit is very useful for us, and they're doing exactly what they need to be doing. But the mayor hit the nail right on the head when he said repeat offenders is a major problem in the zone. Matter of fact, last week we locked up two burglars. One had 32 cycles. What a cycle mean is he's been locked up 32 times and convicted for different crimes. Another one had 23 cycles, and he was back out there on the street again committing more burglaries. Our burglary unit picked these guys up because neighbors, you all, saw them doing what they was doing. You called us, you kept an eye on them, you gave us a good lookout, and we picked them up. So that's very important that the neighborhoods get involved in crime fighting. We always preach the clean car campaign. Clean your cars out. Don't leave anything of value in your cars, because most of these criminals are opportunistic. They're walking by, they see a laptop, they see a gun, they see whatever sitting in your seat. They may not be a criminal, but they're going to become a criminal that day, you know, and break the window out and steal something out of your car. So clean your cars out, and if you see something, always call us, always say something. 911, 911, 911. You will not overuse 911. You call us, we will respond in a prompt manner. So I thank you, and I welcome any of your questions you have concerning Zone 3 issues.
Thank you, Captain Corrine. Our final panel member is works in Zone 6, and he's the Assistant Commander, and that's Captain Benny McGee.
Hey, good evening. I'm Captain Ben McGee. I'm here for Major Peak. I think he's worked tirelessly 7 days a week for the last 2 years, and he's enjoying a few days off. So I'll do my best to fill his big shoes tonight. Just wanted to say Zone 6 is near and dear to my heart. I started there in 1989 as a police recruit and grew up in the Decatur area right nearby. So I'm completely devoted to the Zone 6, and I'm improving the life quality of life over there. I was asked to cover some of the challenges we're facing. Just like the rest of the city, juvenile offenders. Just recently we got 3 juveniles in a stolen car, and we feel your frustration. Trust me, the officers feel it also. Fulton County Juvenile would not accept these juveniles in the stolen car because of their lack of points because of the juvenile justice system. So those officers and I, we feel your frustration. Also recidivists, that's a national problem. It's also a problem here in Atlanta. Recently had an offender that had 62 prior arrests. Can you imagine somebody being arrested 62 prior times? That's 62 times an officer drove him to jail, 62 times he went to court, 62 times he wrote an offense report, 62 cycles. It's unacceptable. Some of the things we're doing, we're embracing technology, predictive policing. Zone 6, we deploy our officers in 1,000 different spots per week on 89 P's, which are predpol pullouts. The VIC, we have surveillance cameras, some covert, some overt, which we made arrests through those VIC cameras. Every day, Major Peak and I, when we get up, assess the crime, we assess the crime trends throughout the day, and we deploy our resources where the hot spots are for that day and that week. Some of the resources we've requested outside our division have really helped us with arrests. Recently, Apex got some armed robbers for us. We've got Apex, we've got the motorcycle unit, we've had the high intensity traffic unit, we've got resources coming in. All of our B cars are filled on a daily basis, but we welcome these outside incidents. My colleagues kid me about being a numbers and a stats guy, so I won't bore you with all of them, but so far this year we put 22 people, so far this year, 22 people in jail in Zone 6 for robbery, 18 ag assault, 12 burglars, 441 quality of life arrests, and we arrested a whopping total of 1,068 people so far this year. So our staff are working. They're out there working, and we care. Thank you, Chief.
All right. Thank you, Captain McGee. And again, we do have the DA's office here with us tonight. They will, they've agreed to stay around after the, after we finish the discussion here tonight and answer whatever questions you may have for them. So they're sitting down here in this left corner with the Deputy Director, Shandina Morris, representing Paul Howard's office. Also, just want to make sure we acknowledge Judge Jane Morrison. Okay, yes, ma'am. All right, thank you for being here. So next, I'd like to call up our Field Operations Division's Commander, which is Deputy Chief Joseph Spillane, and he's going to do a quick update on some of the crime and some of the things that's going on citywide, and just give you a better perspective of what's going on in our city.
Hi, everybody, again. Deputy Chief Spillane with Field Operations, and what that means is I'm in charge of all the police cars out there in all six of the precincts. But just to give you a stat for a minute, we this year have put 10,577 people in jail, and about 68% of the people we put in jail in the City of Atlanta jail have been there before. So when we talk about recidivism, it's a real problem for us when people get out of jail after multiple times and they end up committing a murder or a rape or armed robbery. So we feel it, and it hurts us all as a society to allow that to continue. So I'll just echo everybody else's points about recidivism, and I believe the mayor's statistics is probably true. If we put a certain number of these repeat offenders in jail for a long time, our crime rate would go down significantly, 30% probably. But for me to sit up here and tell you that we are down since 2009 when the mayor took over, 28% in the city, we're almost even for the year, and we have turned that corner. But we have things happen in the city. The murder at Kroger, two murders in Little Five Points, robberies in the old Fourth Ward, car break-ins in the old Fourth Ward, car break-ins in Grant Park, gang-related shootings in Zone 3, retaliation shootings in Zone 3. We have Chief Tolleson here, and if you want to hear some stories about what we're doing with some of these gang members, we're targeting them. We have a great gang database that we put them into, and we track these guys. And the only reason we haven't had more significant gang activity in the city is because his unit, his gang unit, is doing such a good job of putting these people in federal prison. So we have a violent repeat offender program. We meet with the U.S. attorney every month, and we bring these gang members before them. We bring their files before them. And if they adopt them and they convict them, they will go away for 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. And we won't see them again because there's no parole. There's no good behavior. They serve most of their time. So that's a good program. But in the city, we see these changes in these high crimes in these areas that we're not used to seeing murders. We're not used to seeing murders in Little Five Points. I hang out in the Virginia Highlands. I'm not used to seeing cars broken into in the parking lots. And so as the mayor said, we're going to put resources on it. And we have been. We've turned the corner in Zone 6 and in Zone 3 with pushing these numbers back down. I won't say to an acceptable level, but pushing them back down. And my job as FOD commander, and if I don't do that job, Chief Turner will throw me to the lions over here. So I gotta make sure that I appropriately allocate the resources from in FOD and throughout the city. So I can't steal folks from the West End to work the East Side, or from the West Side to Buckhead, or from Northwest to downtown. So I have to balance these things out, and I balance it based on statistical numbers of crime and statistical numbers of types of crime. So some of the patterns we see, I think we've got a thematic map that we can put up, if we can click that. Ms. Espy, you have a clicker? No? Oh, there we go. So if you look at this thematic map, this just takes, the red is bad. So in the red areas where we see a significant combinations of crime, whether it be everything from murder to auto theft. And those areas of the city have significantly more crime than other areas of the city. So when people ask for resources in certain areas of the city, if I'm having robbery problems and gang shooting problems in Mechanicsville, it's unlikely I can pull many of those people out of that area and put them in an area where I might be having property crimes, Lenox Mall or Phipps Plaza, where I might be having shoplifting. And so it's difficult when we look at these maps and these statistics, and every morning we have a conference call, the chief and all the deputy chiefs and some key personnel have a conference call. We talk about these maps. We talk about the numbers. We talk about the last 24 hours of crime. We talk about where we're putting our resources. I think, turn to the next slide. There we go. So this is Zone 3 and Zone 6. This is a grid map just for Zone 3 was the prior one. Zone 6 is this one. And so when you see areas like Old Fourth Ward, and you see areas like Little Five Points, you'll notice some crimes are happening in those areas. Now, we use a system called PREDPO, Predictive Policing, every single police officer's car. Because of the current administration, we really started investing in technology. Every car is a Wi-Fi hotspot. They can get onto Predictive Policing and look at the maps themselves. They can look at just larceny from vehicles, just robberies, or whatever they want to look at, whatever they're trying to target. And they can see graphically where these crimes are occurring by 3 day, 7 day, 21 day, 28 day, or any period of time they wish to look at them. So the officers out there are really trying to work hard. We're trying to get this crime problem under control, and I'm committed, as is the command staff and the command of the police department. We're all committed to being here with you guys. I know we want to get to questions, so I won't talk a lot about the numbers, but the numbers are turning around statistically. I know that doesn't help you if your car got broken into or if your house got broken into, but we are working to push those numbers down. Chief Jones, that's all I have as far as crimes for now.
All right, well, thank you. Thank you for that update on crime. Now, we will move into the question and answer phase of the program. Just want to remind you that, you know, we have two microphones up front. If you wish to come down and ask a question, just make sure you indicate who that question is for. Just raise your hand. Or they're actually going to bring it up to you as we move forward in the process. We could go ahead and start with one question from the audience, and I'll read some from the cards that I have as well.
I just want to thank Zone 6 and Chief Turner. I've been in my house 35 years. I've never been broken into or robbed or stolen anything from. I see the policemen canvassing my neighborhood all the time. I give them thumbs up. Much respect, much love, much respect. I hope you do a damn good job, and I hope God continue to bless you. Anytime you do something for somebody that you can't do for yourself, you really can't put a price on it, and you got your life on the line. Much respect. I've never been broken or robbed. Love you very much.
Thank you. All right, thank you. Okay, go ahead.
Yes, my name is Joy Smith. I'm from Southeast Atlanta at Southside Concerns. My name is Joy Smith. I'm with Southside Concerned Citizens Association. My concern is in my community that there's been a lot of shooting. I'm sure you heard on the news today that two young people got shot on the Old Drive at Empire Park. It's been a lot of shootings in my community. Every day, just about shooting. What can I do, what can we do together as a community and as a police department to help us get more officers out there?
Well, you talk about our officers getting out on the streets. We've got to do things differently. We have a finite number of officers. We have 2,000 officers that we have assigned. About 150 of those are in training. So we have what we have. How we deploy those units, we've talked about that a little bit today. We've got to get smarter. So the question is, what's going on? We always talk about numbers, and I'm going to give you some more numbers. Last week alone, we took another 40 weapons off the streets. Thus far this year, we've already taken an additional 455 guns off the streets. So the question is, what can we do? We know that the weapon that the individual yesterday that shot at our police officers was a stolen weapon that was stolen out of the city of Atlanta in April of last year. And so the question is what do we do collectively? We will be out there patrolling, making sure our officers are on the spot, but we've got to work collectively. I think we've got enough people in this room to have conversations about what we can do differently. Our police officers, we're out there patrolling, we're utilizing technology to make sure that we are on the right spot. So the question is what's next? My wife always get on me that I take too much of the responsibility. My job is to protect and serve the city as a police officer. We have to make sure that we bring everyone in the room and talk about solutions. And I'm prepared to listen to anyone that have an answer, and we'll do everything we can to implement that suggestion.
All right, thank you.
My name is Hattie Bryant, Resident Association President at Lakewood Christian Manor, a senior citizen high-rise facility. I want to commend the City of Atlanta for how they have helped us to bring our neighborhood at zero tolerance for burglaries of our automobiles. That's the first thing I want to say. We can sleep now. We don't have to stay up all night looking out the window, worried about who's going to break in our cars. So for the past year, I can say that we have zero burglaries in our cars, and we don't have any cars stolen. So that's really good. But I want to say that it takes more than the police to do it. You have to do your part also. Channel 11 did a documentary of our neighborhood when we had 11 cars broken into and stolen. And we had problems with our security lights. And Channel 11 came out and did a segment, and I was on that segment. And I said that you have to fight for your neighborhood. And I stand here tonight to tell all of you, you have to do your part, the police do their part. You have to get involved in your neighborhood. You got to get to know your neighbors. You can't be afraid. You cannot be afraid. Most people are afraid. You can't be afraid. You got to step out. When you make that step, your neighbor going to make that step. Your neighbor going to be up looking out the window just like you. If you see something don't feel right in your gut, just call 911. Now, I'm going to tell you, the 911 operator don't like it when you call, but you just tell them, look, I got this feeling. And most of the time, this feeling is right. It is right. I looked out of my window one morning at 3 a.m. in the morning, and I got this gut feeling that something wasn't right. I saw a truck out there. And they hauled a car off. And I told that 911 operator, she said, this is your car. I said, no. And she said, well, this is not yours, then we're not sending anybody. And she did.
Excuse me,
ma'am. The police did not come.
Do you have
a
question?
I'm saying this to you. You got to be persistent. Be
persistent. Miss, do you have a question? Do you have a question?
Now I want to tell you what you can do. All right. Now that I said that much, quick. All right, I want you to go to the schools, educate our children, get with the principals there. That's where it starts, right in the schools, right there. Educate the children how to talk to the police, okay? And how to address the police. Educate them.
Yes, ma'am.
And I have more to give to you.
All right, thank you.
Everybody, thank you.
But
I want to say that.
All right, we're going to go with the cars. I have a question here from the cars. I want to make sure everybody can have an equal opportunity to get their questions in. And this question would be for our Zone 6 Assistant Commander, Benny McGee, pretty much in respect to the spike in violent crimes that have been occurring in the neighborhoods north of DeKalb Avenue. What's being done to address those concerns?
Yeah, we've moved our crime suppression unit over there. I don't want to give the staffing numbers, but we did double the size of the crime suppression unit. That unit operates in an undercover capacity. Half of the unit is undercover in undercover vehicles. The other half are uniformed. They conduct surveillance. We've embraced the PredPol. Our arrest numbers are up in the area. We've really done everything possible, invited outside resources, including Apex, even the State Patrol. I've made requests from them for the Nighthawks unit. So we've really, it's a combined effort that takes everybody involved. I'm also attending the MPU meetings. And really, we haven't talked about it yet, but I'd really like to get people involved with Court Watch. When we have these recidivists that have been arrested so many times, and y'all know who these people are because the community knows them better than we do, we've got to get involved with Court Watch to make sure there's judicial accountability, that these guys are not getting out on signature bonds the minute the officer leaves court. We really need that.
All right, thank you. Next. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Steve Van Ginkle, professor at Georgia Tech Environmental Engineering. Stephen Van Ginkle, I'm a Georgia Tech professor of civil and environmental engineering. I think all your comments sound genuine. I've seen dozens of reports about increased military presence across the country. So I was just wondering, I was hoping Kasim could be here still, but did his meeting with the Bilderberg group, or did anything federal come down to you guys to increase your presence other than what you're saying today, other than crime, safety? Did anybody ever tell you that we need to increase military presence? I'm sorry, not police presence, as part of some kind of police state, some kind of militarization of your police, because it does follow a trend nationwide. Thank you.
Chief Turn.
I'll answer that. No one has ever come down to ask us to add additional presence or have military presence in our city. Our question and our request come from citizens in the community that are making outcry that we need to have more presence of our officers in the community. As relates to military, we do partner the best we can with all individuals, but we've not called the National Guard, if you're talking specifically about to come out. We did partner with them during the 4th of July, during the 10K, and that's the only time that we've called on our partners from the military. Please follow up. I don't know what you're saying.
Do you have
saying.
A follow up?
So this increased presence has 100% to do with safety and crime.
So this increased presence that Kasim mentioned has 100% to do with crime and safety, and has nothing to do with any kind of federal action or Bilderberg Group decision that was given to Kasim?
No, sir. There's no conspiracy associated with the deployment of our officers.
Conspiracy has a bad connotation.
Well, then the answer to that is no.
Okay. All right. Yes. Young man over here.
Good evening. Can you hear me? My name is Ricky Clark. I'm an appointed official in the city of Jonesboro. Thanks to Councilman Martin for telling me about this event tonight. I'll start with my question. My question primarily is, when will the profiling by police officers stop? I'm grateful to say that in the community I live in off of Camp Creek, Officer Clay was excellent to us, but on Sunday, I was pulled over on North Avenue by two officers, and the statement that was made to me when they approached my car was that we smell marijuana coming from your vehicle. First of all, I've been in government for 12 years, 7 of those years as an appointed official. And my question is, when will that profiling stop? That simple traffic pullover could have ruined my career. And I'm gracious enough to say that in Clayton County, we too have high crime levels. However, you know, if we're going to, I think we need to go back to the basics. We're talking about all of the things that we can do to combat crime. What are we doing to train our officers? That was the most embarrassing moment of my life, being pulled over for the special intel that the city of Atlanta has in unmarked vehicles. And I question that intel, because if there is such a thing, we need to purchase the same for our Jonesboro police officers, because we don't have it. Furthermore, and I'm nervous because I've never presented an issue like this. And I'm not going to use the key word that it was a racial profiling, because it was a black officer and a white officer that pulled me over. Someone that has never been arrested a day in their life, someone that has never used marijuana a day in my life. I make a decent living by working for the government, college degreed. I've worked every day of my life, never looked for a handout. And it can't happen. You know, I am going full-fledged with this complaint. I will not stop until I know those officers no longer have a job, because for someone that doesn't smoke marijuana, there's no way that you can detect marijuana. My last statement, if I was in my Mercedes, but they still had pulled me over.
Well, thank you, sir. That's a personal situation. If you have an issue like that, before you leave, I'll have someone to get your information, and we'll investigate that as of tonight. We'll start that tonight.
I appreciate it, Chief. And one thing I'll add, the Atlanta Citizens Review Board is very responsive. However, when searching through the City of Atlanta website, I couldn't find any email address for any chief official. And I think, as a public servant, the email addresses of our officials are important. If you want to be of value to our citizens, make your information readily available so that we can contact you when we have issues.
All right, thank you. So I'll go back. I'm going to go back to the cars. Please, though, as you come to the mic, we ask that you have questions. We're trying to solve crime issues in the community. Just please turn that into a question so that we can address whatever the crime issues are. I have a question here for Raines Carter. Raines, basically said that you mentioned the broken windows theory when you spoke. And as a component of it all is the illegal promotional flyers that are posted on telephone poles. And just want to know whether or not there's going to be something reinstated as it relates to prosecuting individuals that put those flyers on the poles.
Thanks for the question. The answer is absolutely, positively. We are partnering with the Department of Public Works and APD and other agencies for the city. Chief Turner has put together a very good process for code enforcement officers to have the authority delegated by him to issue citations. We're also putting more in-house code enforcement officers into other departments of the city. The mayor and the council have actually now added code enforcement officers to my office. And we have had pretty much a downturn years ago, 2007, 2008, in that particular type of enforcement. I've had some discussions with some elected officials about it, especially a particular state representative. And I want you to know that we're going to be increasing our code enforcement for the sign ordinance. There's a number that I can give out for the code enforcement people in my office, 404-658-6300. And if you're not getting a response from other agencies, call us directly. We'll come out, take a look at it, and get some citations out.
All right. Thank you, Ray. So please indicate who your question is to so they can address it and go forward.
I'd like to talk specifically to Raines Carter. And y'all police as lobbyists for us citizens. And as far as the citizens are concerned, a short-term solution to this is go to your neighborhood meetings. The police show up. Ask them questions. Number two is, you've mentioned recidivism. Captain McGee has. 68%. Well, gee, Raines Carter, get them into trade school. Give them a scholarship while they're in jail. So they can get a trade so they won't have to be arrested 30 times, 40 times, 50 times that we're paying for. We have a punitive system as far as code enforcement. There's a program in East Atlanta called Neighbors in Need. I suggest you take a look at that. Also, I want to leave you my phone number because I want to talk with you about some other programs that are in the works, but not with the city of Atlanta, and they should be. We have an ongoing punitive process. You talk about racial profiling, we got a punitive process in the whole system. Go look at the cattle call in municipal court. And most of those people are poor, dumb, or crazy. And it bothers me that y'all college graduates and government take advantage of these people instead of a positive program to help people do whatever they need to do.
So do you have a question? Do you have a question?
I've got some other solutions too, and they're long term. They won't happen overnight. And that is get together with the school system. Have the high school people go to the neighborhood meetings or any other political or community meeting. Take notes, and the next day in their civics or social science class, which I hear some of them don't have anymore, give a report on what they saw and heard or what they didn't see and hear. Lay it out.
Good. Okay, so we'll move on. We're going to move on,
yes,
sir.
Yes, my question is, Raines, would you call me back, please?
Yes, sir, I will.
All right, next question. This question is Deputy Chief Spillane.
I did want to take an opportunity to address something that Mr. Carr said. There is an initiative by our City Department of Corrections working together with Atlanta Workforce Development there's an initiative now about placing some of the job counselors right there in the correction center. When people come in and that are booked in, one of the things that we're looking at now, and I'm part of an ongoing grant committee that meets weekly. I see we have other members of the committee here, Deputy Commissioner Terry Lee and others that are part of that grant commission, where we are exploring the use of federal funds and state CJCC funds to set up work development programs for people that are incarcerated, because the whole issue is, well, what happens when you get out of jail? And so they're going to start taking some initial intake information. So that first part of what he said, there is actually some impetus behind that. And of course, your other comments are well taken. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Raines. So the next question is, the Deputy Chief Spillane, where are the majority of the criminals committing Part 1 crimes coming from, if one, and what are we doing in those areas to address them, those Part 1 crimes?
So the people who are... Can everybody hear me? Yeah. So the people who come to the communities to address crime in many cases live in the communities. And if you're specifically talking about Zone 6 or Zone 3, it could be a little bit different. So when we arrest people, we do map where they live and kind of the routes they would take. We do the same thing when we recover stolen vehicles. We look at where it came from and how did it get to where it is. So in general, what we do, for instance, we did a detail earlier this year with our violent crime initiative at 2500 Center Street, which is in Northwest Atlanta. And you wouldn't think 2500 Center Street in Northwest Atlanta would have anything to do with car break-ins or cars being stolen from Southeast Atlanta. But what we were finding were 19, 20 cars a month showing up at this apartment complex at 2500 Center. So we did a detail, and that's how we combat that. We look at the areas that our criminals are coming from, where we're finding our abandoned vehicles, where we have violence, and we do things in that community, whether it's a detail to reduce violent crime in that community, whether it's working with the juveniles in that community to get them into one of our summer camps or one of our PAL programs, or with our workforce development agency, get them a summer intern, a job, get them off the street. And so that's what we do. We look at these patterns, and it happens every day. We look at where these kids are from, where these adults are from, and how did they get to the community. And we also look at, of course, the bus lines and the train, and sometimes they'll take trains and they'll take buses. And we target those areas where we see increases in crime due to people moving about in the city. So I hope that answers the question.
All right. Thank you, Chief Spillane. Okay. We'll go here. Okay. So please keep your question. Try to answer it under 1 minute, and we'll direct it to who you wanted to go to.
Phil Barnett, Images Enterprises. Sorry. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
I'm a contractor with the City of Atlanta. So your issue right now is the crime, right? So let me help you solve your problem.
Please.
Because I did it in Brooklyn. I did it in Rochester, New York. I was going to do it in Newburgh, but the mayor thought something different. And this was for the mayor. And you mentioned the AWDA, and they have my proposal on their desk, but they denied me. What I'm trying to do is train your felons, your misdemeanors, and get them working again. You guys have 54 buildings in the City of Atlanta, and out of the 54, I painted two of them. And the mayor's project at the cafeteria, I was the one who painted that project. So if you can guarantee me 100,000 square feet monthly for the next 3 years, I can guarantee you your crime rate will go down. And you already have the proposal. You can look at it. Mr. Amit knows about it. But the people in the community, if you can look in the audience, no one's in their 20s, 25, 19-year-olds. Those are the people that's committing the crimes. So if they're not, yeah, but how many people you have here? If you don't have the people in the community that you think are committing the crimes at these meetings, you're going to have a major issue. And there is a gap between the 40-year-olds and the 20-year-olds. I want to be the liaison. So if you got anybody coming out of jail that wants to work, that wants to get trained, tell them to holler at Images and we'll take care of them.
All right, thank you. So that we can get to more questions on the panel, this is for Judge Brad Boyd, Chief Turner, and maybe even Raines Carter may want to take this particular question. According to the person who wrote this question, this is the third crime meeting that we've attended, and we've heard that we need help. How do the individual citizens provide the help that we need in our community? can hear. So I repeat that question to say, the question starts by saying, this is the third meeting in which I've attended and heard we need your help. How do individuals, citizens, provide the help that we need to fight crime?
You can ask.
I think that tonight is a prime example. Coming out and participating in the process, coming up with those ideas that you have so that we can implement those and become more effective as a city. I think that the gentleman just spoke about providing work for individuals that have been arrested. I know that the Atlanta Workforce Development is working very closely with the Westside Works program. I had an opportunity to visit the new stadium that they were under construction. That job right now have 720 men and women working in concrete only. And they plan to employ more than 2,000 individuals. And the lowest paying job there is $15 an hour. And they're working with the Atlanta Workforce Development as well as Westside Works to train individuals who are felons, misdemeanor convictions, so that they can begin having an opportunity to work. We know that we have to have the entire community working together, coming up with solutions to solve these problems. I've heard multiple individuals tonight talk about education being a challenge for us. We know that that's an issue. We know that if a young man or woman does not have an education, does not have an opportunity to get a meaningful employment, then they are going to create a problem for all of us. And so what I would encourage you to do is to continue to stay involved. I think Steve said it best as well. We are in all community meetings, our MPU meetings. Our police officers are there and all department heads from the city is there to hear concerns so that we can work together and find solutions to these problems. But it's not going to happen in a large meeting like this. We have to continue to stay engaged.
Thank you. Judge Boyd?
A long time ago, I started work in juvenile court as a probation officer, and my territory was a lot of Zone 3, Cabbage Town and so on. That was 40-some years ago. What I knew about that time was that if I would go into the community and I was looking for a particular young person, I could ask the neighbors, oh yeah, I know where he is, so I'm down there. And neighbors, people in the community knew the kids there. Now granted, the city of Atlanta and our neighborhoods have changed a lot. But I'd like to encourage you to, if you see young people on the street, don't be scared of them if they're just on the street. Don't wait for them to get into trouble before you call 911. If you see them out there, talk to them. See what's going on with them. Get to know them. Got a job to do around the house. Hey, would you like to earn a few bucks? I could use some help here in the backyard. If you develop some relationships with some of the young people in the community and give them a connection to that community, they start looking at their own neighborhood a lot differently. And I've had some young people come into court that a neighbor will come along and say, I know this young man. I've been talking to him for a long time. He made a mistake. I'm going to watch him. I know his mom's not home during the day. He can come over to my place until his mom gets home. Let me encourage you, particularly with the young people in your community, get to know them.
Thank you. Rings, you wanna?
Another thing that I believe would be helpful, I just want to echo what Judge Boyd said. To the extent that you can, especially through your neighborhood organizations, please work with us in establishing court watch programs. The district attorney's office has had a very strong court watch program. We've had back and forth at the city level. I know you're hardworking people and you can't necessarily all come to court yourself, but through your representatives, if you can designate someone, that helps a lot because we as prosecutors and judges, we need to know more about the impact of these types of offenses on your community. We have the ability to consider impact statements, and we'd like you to become involved as much as possible. I can share information before the meeting is over, a couple of telephone numbers that I can give you so that you can engage our investigators internally so that we can have you there with us. It makes a difference when you're there.
Thank you, Rains. Take the lady over here on the left.
Chief Turner, good evening. This seems a little like Robin Hood to me. I need to know, why would you take away Zone 3 location to accommodate Zone 6? How would you accommodate Zone 3?
I'm sorry, I don't understand the question.
Okay, I need to know. I need for it to make sense to me. The location of Zone 3 as of now is on Cherokee.
That's right, I got
so
you.
So my under... You got my question?
Yes, ma'am.
I need to know how you going to accommodate us when you're taking all of Zone 3 again to Zone 6 location. Where do Zone 3 residents go now?
Okay, let me...
That don't make sense.
Okay, let me try to help you understand our decision. So about 2 years ago, we did a beat redesign, if you recall. We ended up putting the geographical area that's the Zone 3 space is in now presently in the Zone 6 space. There was a reason that we did that. We tried to split up and make sure that the workload was measured throughout the entire city. Now, there is a commitment from the administration. We've already purchased the land to build a new precinct in the Zone 3 geographical area. There should be a groundbreaking before the end of the third quarter of this year at the property that we've already purchased.
Is that on Metropolitan?
Yes, it is.
It's away from us.
But it's in the middle of the Zone 3 space.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, so I'm going to read another question from the card here. Now, Judge Boyd, one particular part of this question asks about longer sentences for juveniles in detention.
There's a couple things that I'm hearing there. Longer sentences for juveniles in detention?
Yeah, how can we get longer sentences for juveniles that are in detention?
More education for juveniles.
Well, when a juvenile is brought to detention, they're held in the detention center until the court, until they go to court. And if they're found delinquent, which is like being found guilty, then the sentencing happens after that. The sentencing structure that we have has been set out. We have probation available, and within our probation system, we have quite a number of various programs that we can get young people in. We have a mentoring program, we have a chess program, we have tutoring programs. We have a number of programs, most of which are volunteer driven. We have some, as I mentioned, some grant programs from the state for the more serious offenders. Any juvenile that the court decides is not going to benefit from these various programs can be committed to the Department of Juvenile Justice under guidelines that are set up by the code, the new code, and the Department of Juvenile Justice. If they are committed to the Department of Juvenile Justice, then unless they are committed under the Special Designated Felony Act, which actually sets sentences for very serious offenders, where they go, where they're placed, and whether they're incarcerated or placed in the community or placed somewhere else is up to the Department of Juvenile Justice, not the courts. Where are the Department of Juvenile Justice?
As in, is there a representative here that we can talk to?
Where's the mayor? I thought he called this meeting. I guess he has something to report.
There was an invite to the juvenile justice system, and they did not come to the meeting. We invited them to come.
All right. So, yes, sir, you want to ask a question?
Okay. My name is Mark Tanner. I'm in Edgewood, Zone 6. And my question is for the mayor, and I'll direct it to Chief Turner in his absence. In his opening statement, he said that he was going to dedicate more resources starting tonight to the APD, Zone 3 and 6, or in general. Want to know, first of all, what that is, and then he said, secondly, as far as recidivism, he needs our help. What is that?
Well, there's a couple of things. I'll tell you about, as I understand what the mayor meant about adding additional resources. As we move into our summer plan and even tonight, we've extended overtime so that we can have officers work more hours in the area that he's concerned for. And so he's authorizing additional overtime to have more patrol. That's the only way we can increase the patrol with the existing resources that we presently have, first. And then the other point, we have been involved, the mayor actually pulled together a repeat offender commission. We've been working with the judges in Fulton County, as well as the DA's office and a number of other officials to talk about how we deal with this repeat offender issue. Through the Police Foundation, has produced a report, and there are some recommendations there. We've made those recommendations to each of the various different disciplines. And how I believe that you can help us is that you hold us, each one of the disciplines, accountable as citizens. We will provide the information as we track these repeat offenders, and we'll provide a quarterly report to the community on what's going on and what has happened to the individuals that we've arrested. We have to first start off with good, clean information, and we're starting to do that. We have stood up a repeat offender office inside of our office, inside of the police department, to pull all of that data together and release that on a quarterly basis. And so I would just simply say that the citizens have an obligation to hold those various different disciplines responsible for their commitments that they've made to protect and serve our citizens.
All right. Thank you, Chief. The young lady on the left.
Thank you. My name is Anna Korean. I am a recent homeowner in East Atlanta. And my question is in two parts, one to my good friends at the district attorney's office, and second to the police. And the question to the police is, we know from all of this data that locking people up is not working. So my question is, do you, as a police department, when you encounter someone who's mentally ill, when you encounter someone who has substance abuse issues, prostitution, whatever it is, do you have a pre-arrest diversion program that directly goes to address the issue before this person is locked up, before all of us are paying our taxpayer dollars for this person to wait to go to court? We're housing them at $80 a day, paying for three meals, when the simple issue could be, this person is mentally ill, let me take them to the 13th floor of Grady. This person has a substance abuse issue, it's a nonviolent offense, let me put them in a drug program. So my question is there a pre-arrest diversion program? And my question to the DA's office is, what measures are being done to address the root issues of nonviolent offenders? Because from what I understand, repeat offenders, for the most part, the data looks good, but these are nonviolent offenders. And I, certainly as a taxpayer, do not want to be paying money to house someone when I could be better using my tax dollars to, for plenty of other things. But why are we locking people up when we know what the solution is?
Well, I disagree with you, first of all. Hold, please don't walk away. First of all, if you look at what goes on in other counties around the metro area, we do make a lot of arrests, but there's no time being spent for the crime that they commit. Nonviolent crimes, by the way, are people's cars being broken into, that you're complaining to the police department on a regular basis. Your homes are being broken into. Those are the same issues that are nonviolent offenses that I constantly get concerns about when we go into communities. Now, as it relates to pre-arrest issues, the police department is not responsible for that. That's why it takes all of us talking about the issues that we're concerned for. I do not have a pre-arrest issues that we can provide our officers to prevent or take a person to. Give me the resources and we'll utilize the tool.
We have them.
No, you don't. No, you don't. No, you do not. The county is responsible.
All right, thank you. So, next question. Zone 6, this is Captain Benny McGee. This is your question. There has been an increase in crime around the Edgewood Avenue area. What can we do? What do we need to do to get extra foot patrols or bike patrols on the weekends?
We've got every one of our B car staff. Like I said, we have limited resources that we work with. We've called in outside units. Our hotspots change daily and they change weekly. We move the resources that we have on a daily and weekly basis depending on what's going on. Some weeks Edgewood may be completely quiet with nothing going on. We may have to move them to East Atlanta. Some weeks we may have to move them down to Little Five Points. So when we need outside resources, we call them in from other divisions, and we have done that.
All right. Thank you. Miss. Yes, ma'am.
Left. No, you're going back.
Okay. That's fine.
Hi, my name is Dean Steed. I'm a member with Solutions Not Punishment Coalition. You all talked about higher recidivism rates. Well, high recidivism rates are a clear indication that your approach is failing. More police is failing us. As a black, lesbian, gender non-conforming person, I've been met with more police brutality than police protection. Longer sentences are not working. What does work is providing people with the mental health services they need, the substance abuse services they need, and the job training services they need. You said that we do not have the resources to do that. Other cities are doing that, and Solutions Not Punishment Coalition members and City Councilman Kwanzaa Hall will be traveling to Seattle on Tuesday to witness the Seattle Pre-Diversion Program, LEADS, Law Enforcement Assistant Diversion Program. They are doing it there, and we can do it here. So if you're truly committed to seeing transformation in the reduction of crime in the city of Atlanta, you will commit to going on that trip so that you can learn and educate your officers on how to better serve our communities through pre-arrest diversion programs, because transformation does not happen within prisons.
Thank you. We attended that. We visited Seattle last year, so we've looked at that program. Thank you, ma'am.
All right. Thank you. Miss, you have a question?
I do. First of all, thank you for you and the other officers that are putting their lives on the line every day to serve our community.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
And I think we've heard a lot of emphasis around some of the solutions for preventing crime, whether that's community-based or within the existing system. We've also heard about the high degree of arrest rates. Mayor Peek attends our community meetings and has shared his frustration at the repeat offenders. I, for one, am completely outraged that there are people in the city who have been arrested 90, 77, 30, I mean, am I the only one?
No.
This is ridiculous. It's ridiculous because it disrespects the law-abiding taxpayers in the city. It disrespects the officers who have put their lives on the line as their career choice to protect us. And ultimately, it disrespects the perpetrators because it teaches them that they can ignore the law and that there is no proper punishment.
Yes, ma'am.
So my question is, where is the breakdown? Is this a legislative thing? Is this a law that needs to be changed? Are there judges that need to be voted out? What do we need to do? Because I have to go to work. I can't come sit in the court and make sure that somebody's actually doing the thing that I've already paid them to do.
That's right. All right, thank you. Judge Boyd, would you like to take a stab at that particular question? Judge Boyd, would you like to take a stab at that question or response? Concerning recidivism.
Well, in juvenile court, if any juvenile that comes in that has a record, we don't have that kind of recidivism rate in juvenile court. If they're developing that kind of record, then they're probably passed on and committed to the Department of Juvenile Justice much sooner than you build up those kinds of arrests. Now, we do have, as I mentioned earlier, we do know that simply locking kids up on the long run doesn't make a lot of change. The kids that have been locked up in secure facilities have about a 90% recidivism rate. They don't recommit offenses while they're locked up, but when they get out, we really haven't solved the problem, and they will get out. Now, we do have a program in juvenile court with some grants from the state where some of these young people that are at high, they measure at high risk for recidivism, are put in. We have several programs. They're very intensive programs. They involve therapy within the family sometimes three and four times a week. They involve involvement of some very intensive education programs. And so far, we've been doing that for about a year and a half now. Our recidivism rate of those youngsters in that in those programs is fairly good. I don't really have the numbers, but it's significantly better than those that have been committed in the past. So we do have some seed money from the state with some programs that we feel are working. We have just gotten word we're going to be able to expand those programs next year. We're getting a couple more million dollars more than we had this year. And we're very hopeful that we can cut down even more significantly on the recidivism rate.
All right, thank you. So we have about 10 minutes left. We want to make sure we can get as many questions as it relates to Zone 3 and Zone 6 in terms of the crime issues occurring in Zone 3 and Zone 6. Yes, sir.
Okay. Good evening. My name is William Harrison. I'm the board chair for the Atlanta Citizens Review Board. And thank you, Chief Turner, for, you know, your support and everything. I know the mayor has supported us as well. And I do believe in your community policing, you know, program and the way you've approached it. I have two requests, not a question. See, my first request is that we weren't invited. And anytime you talk about community policing, I think that the ACRB should be invited. And the second request is that we have a number of attorneys that have criminal justice backgrounds on the ACRB, and we'd like to be involved in trying to help reduce the recidivism rate as it, you know, as it relates to Atlanta, the city of Atlanta.
Thank you. That is our fault, and we will not have another town hall meeting that we're dealing with subjects such as this without inviting the ACBU. Thank you.
All right, thank you. So someone give a microphone on the left side.
Hi, I'm BT, or organizer with Solutions Not Punishment. And I want to say and plead, my question is, what do we need to do to get the stakeholders? This is the RFP, just came out last week. It won't cost the city anything to at least try this. Atlanta could be a southern vanguard pushing this. Locking up people is not working. People need jobs, not jails. Healthcare, not handcuffs. We're begging you. My question is, how can we've done the work? This is the RFP. We need a stakeholder. I'm sorry the mayor is not here to sign off on this and allow the city to at least try it. It's right here.
Okay. I don't know who to answer that.
All right.
The role of the police, you know the role of police, right? I have. Excuse me, sir. I thought we were going to, okay. You're going to allow me to respond. The fact is, we have roles here. That's why we invited the folk here on this to participate, right? If there was options that the state, that the county, that the city provided our officers with, then we would use that as a tool. We do not have anything that you're talking about as a tool today.
Make it. Mm-hmm.
I can't make it. My role is to be a police chief.
All right, thank you. Sir, okay, we're gonna try to get some more people. Thank you, sir. We've heard the question, we'll take it back. Yes, sir. So ma'am, you have a question?
It's working.
Yes, ma'am, you have a question?
Hi, I'm a resident of Warwood Park in East Atlanta. And I want to know, as we hear every day about police brutality and police violence and police abuse happening across the country and in this region, what is the Atlanta Police Department going to do to say we're not going to stand up for and tolerate police abuse and police violence and racial profiling in this city? Because to me, that is an issue of crime and safety that impacts our neighborhoods.
I will venture to say, we had a shooting last night that our officers were involved in. Involved with a young man, 22 years old, who raised a gun at a police officer who's sworn to protect and serve our citizens. Our officers responded and returned fire on that individual. Now, if you want our officers to just turn and receive fire and not receive or not shoot back, you really barking up the wrong tree. Our officers have a responsibility to protect our citizens, and that is what they've sworn to do. Now, let me give you one other point. The city of Atlanta, when you're talking about the region, let's give you facts. The city of Atlanta, we have more than 2,000 individuals that are sworn to carry guns. Last year alone, we had 9 officer-involved shootings. Yesterday was the first officer-involved shooting that we participated the entire year. That's through training. So I want you to understand, when you have a police department, for instance, like a Ferguson, a 52-man police department that really dictate what law enforcement is doing around the country. Look at departments that are doing this right. And as contrary as you may think, the Atlanta Police Department is a model agent for this country. So I'll take your complaints.
All right. Thank you. All right. Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Hey, first of all, thank you for having this meeting and, you know, talking to us. I'm concerned because my name is Khalil English. I live in Capitol View Manor, and my daughter goes to Perkinson Elementary. Last Sunday, a boy was just playing basketball over at the school and got shot in the stomach. What I want to know is, I see the police there. I heard you say that they're going to have break ground for a precinct. How come I never see any officers in that area on foot that can actually engage with the people who are in the community? Because I see them driving by, I see them going by fast, but I don't know any faces, I don't know anybody there, and I'm out there every day.
That's our failure. And the zone and the precinct commanders, those beat officers have an obligation. First of all, let me just tell you what we're doing. Our police cars, as Chief Spillane talked about, we have the technology to be able to determine what speed they've gone in your neighborhood. We can also determine how often they're in your neighborhood. We can go back 30 days to determine what their patrol patterns have been. So if we have specific issues, we want to get that information, research it, and change what we're seeing. So if there's a specific area, I'll give that to Deputy Chief Spillane, and he'll research that and make sure we change what you're talking about. We require our officers to get out of the cars. When they talk, he talked about 89 Ps. That means that they're getting out of their cars or in an area that we've designed them to get and stop those vehicles and be get out of the car and participate and talk to units, talk to citizens. If they're not doing that, that's our failures. We can correct that.
All right, thank you, Chief. So we have time for one more question. In the event you have individuals,
we'll give him two.
We'll give you two, yes, sir. And if there are any other questions, please, we'll be out after it's over, so go ahead and ask.
I'll keep this brief. In other cities, including this one in the past, in areas of high concentration for bar districts, East Atlanta Village, Little Five Points, Virginia Highlands, et cetera, it used to be a long time ago in Buckhead, before it was torn down, the bar district, there would be a strong foot police presence.
That's correct.
Now in the bar districts around here, I don't sense that same strong police presence. And we had two gentlemen shot and killed in Little Five Points. Augustine's was robbed about a week ago. You know, Patrick Catrona was shot and killed in 2013 in the East Atlanta Village. And I understand you guys are limited in your resources, but is there any plans to increase the police presence as a deterrent in the concentrated bar and restaurant districts?
Well, obviously, everything that we've talked about tonight is about looking at what's going on within the communities and how we actually put those resources in the location that we're having challenges with. There is plans. We've got to make sure, we have about 150 recruits that are in the academy. And as soon as those officers are out of the academy, we'll have additional resources to put on the streets. And then we can put those on foot, put people on foot and then in bicycles so that we can improve the areas that are really just areas that have come up all of a sudden. You know, Fort Worth is a great opportunity for people to hang out, but the fact is that we didn't have to deal with that 3 years ago. But, you know, right now, there's so many different areas. Sweet Auburn is coming back alive again. We've got all of those issues that are new and different for us that we've got to find a way to move our resources around so that we can effectively patrol those areas.
Lastly, I'll be brief. Obviously, you guys are, I can sense your frustration with the recidivism issue. Whom should we direct our emails, phone calls, questions, angst, whatever, towards in order to help with that problem?
Well, I think you should, as you know, there are 22 elected judges.
There's 30 in Fulton County alone.
Each one of those judges, you can write to any of those judges, email those. You can email the district attorney's office, email the juvenile court system, email anyone that's part of the juvenile justice system. And we hope that you can get some results from that. Yes, sir. Last question.
So last question. We will be hanging around after it's over. So if you have a question for us, you can ask us a question after it's over.
I heard you. My name's John Michael. I've been in Atlanta permanently since 82. I've resided in Kirkwood since 90. I'm a law-abiding citizen. I've never touched a police officer. I've never cursed them. But I'm being treated like a criminal, and I want to serve notice that Zone 6 has made that happen. There's a drug house across the street from me. A man was recently shot. The police laugh at me when I report incidents because I'm assertive, like now. I am tired of it, Chief Turner. This is not an ideal state. This is a good police department. They're not sensitivity trained, Chief Turner. They're not. They approach some issues, whether it's a gay issue, a homeless man. They treat the people like criminals before they arrest them. That's the facts. Now, you can say otherwise. I respect the police. I know it's a tough job. I've had relatives that were police. But it doesn't give license to treat people without respect. And that's a major problem in Atlanta. In my personal case, briefly, I just went to court yesterday where a woman made me stand in the rain for 25 minutes, and then two cars individually show up while I'm still in the same place, show up and tell me they're going to take me to jail. I was fortunate I wasn't in Elaine Carlisle's court because she takes every case, builds one from the past on issues that are not in front of her, and makes the people pay large amounts of money. The court system is not working properly. My question to you is, this is my last question. The lady in charge of body cameras was arrested. She was fired by Chief Pennington, her name is C.D. Davis, for protecting pedophiles. She should not be the woman in charge of being rehired, first of all. That's a mystery to me. So now you or others, or collectively, you put her in charge of the body cameras.
So you have a question?
The question is why? Why is C.D. Davis in charge of body cameras when she was fired for protecting pedophiles and never went to jail?
All right, we're going to move forward.
I'm not going to respond
to that,
sir.
Forward. Why not? So can we give our panelists a round of applause, please? That concludes the event for the night. Again, we will be hanging around to answer any questions that someone may have.
You have one youth in line. You will never ask one question. The only youth in the building.
We'll listen to him, please.
Yes, go ahead.
Well, I'm 16 years old, and I stay in the Zone 3 area, Silver Hills, Parkinson Elementary area. And my classmate got shot at Parkinson Elementary School. I walk around the neighborhood every single day, and I see no police in the area patrolling the area. I see gang members at Parkinson Park riding on walls. Why is nothing being done about it? I should feel protected and be able to walk to the park and enjoy myself without worrying about being shot, being killed. Why is nothing being done?
Kevin McGee, you want to talk about the patrols or either?
You are totally correct. You should be protected, and we should be out there. Our officers are designated to drive and patrol certain areas that are high crime areas. Perkinson Park area is one of those areas that we require officers to stop over there and park and you know, talk to the neighborhoods and talk to the citizens out there. So I'm going to look into that. I'll make sure that they do get out there and stop. The shooting that happened the other day, it supposedly was related for some youth that didn't like this youth because they thought he was a part of another group, and they just fired on him and left. you know, that was sporadic. It happened while we weren't there, and unfortunately it did happen. But you are right. We should be out there. We should be patrolling. We should be stopping and talking to the citizens. So we will be out there. And we do. We go out there, we chase them, and they run, and we catch as many as we can catch. But you're right. We should be out there. We will be out there.
All right, thank you.